thick fog off the Virginia coast, the steamship Monroe was rammed by the merchant vessel Nantucket and eventually sank. 41 sailors wound up dying in the frigid waters of the Atlantic. They had a hearing to determine the cause of the crash, and they found out that Captain Edward Johnson navigated the ship Monroe with a steering compass that deviated as much as 2 degrees from the standard magnetic compass. When they asked him why he would do that, he said, "The instrument was true enough to run the ship, and besides, it was the custom of other captains to use such compasses." His steering compass had never been adjusted in the entire year that he was the captain of the Monroe. So he is piloting the ship, but the navigation was off. And this shows us the consequences of when you have the wrong orientation. The heart, I'm not talking about the organ that beats blood or pumps blood, but I'm talking about the inmost part of your being. It is the compass of your life, and it will either direct you toward good things or toward bad things, good or bad outcomes. The text that we're going to read speaks about the heart, and we're going to read, I'm actually choosing the NIV translation, and it calls the heart the wellspring. So we're given wisdom here, and it says, above all else, guard your heart. I want to preach about guarding your heart. Proverbs 4, starting at verse 20. My son, pay attention to what I say. Listen closely to my words. Do not let them out of your sight. Keep them within your heart, for their life to those who find them and health to a man's whole body. Above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. Put away perversity from your mouth. Keep corrupt talk from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Make level paths for your feet and take only ways that are firm. Do not swerve to the right or to the left. Keep your foot from evil. Guarding your heart. I want to begin. Let's talk about the wellspring. This text talks about the heart. Verse 23, guard your heart. The heart is your inner being. It is the unseen dimension of life, and yet it is the center of your life. Jeremiah 17:10, God says, I, the Lord, search the heart. And in the King James, he says, I try the reins. And that is an ancient word that we don't use in that way anymore. But literally, I try the reins. It means the kidneys. So in other words, God says, I am looking at the deepest part inside of you. I'm not looking at your face. I'm looking at what is deep inside. And our text calls this the heart. I'm not going to give a full theological treatise of the heart, but your heart involves your emotions, your intellect, your will. But the most important thing is your heart is the seat of your affections and desires. Your heart, there is a part of you that literally what you love more than anything, that is your heart. What you want more than anything, that is your heart. And a heart that is right loves and wants things that are right. A heart that is wrong or bad wants things that are not right and things that are bad. The problem with the heart is that it is unseen. Just like the human heart, not a single one of you can I look and go, good heart, bad heart. I don't know what the physical condition of the organ that pumps blood inside of you, but neither can I just look, make a snap judgment about the heart as well. Our problem is sometimes we can be focused on the outside. We can be satisfied with things that are outside, whether that's church attendance, participation in some way. But our text does not say, guard your face. He says, guard your heart. You can be in the right place with a wrong heart. You can be doing some good things with a wrong heart. And our text tells us why the heart is so important. Verse 23, New King James translation says, NIV rather, first of all, guard your heart above all else, for it is the wellspring of life. Wellspring is the source. You may see the water down in the creek or downstream somewhere. The wellspring is the source. All of the water flows from that. And the Bible says your heart, that unseen dimension that is deep inside of you, it is the source of everything in your life. What you feel is really determined by what is in your heart. What you see, how you interpret life, it comes from the heart. What you want, what you choose, what you do, it all comes from the heart. Proverbs 4:23 in the New King James, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows all of the issues of life. See, when our hearts are good, then it is what we see. We see things correctly. We want things. We want good things. We choose. We act based on what our heart is. Matthew 6:22 says, the lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, then he says your whole body will be full of light. So he says, literally in life, what you see, sometimes I talk to people and they're telling me how they're seeing things. I'm like, that is, wow. How's that possible that we're looking at the same things, but we're coming to radically different conclusions? The heart. And then, of course, if your hearts are bad, we see things wrong, we interpret things wrong, we want bad things, we choose bad things, we do bad things. Matthew 6:23, if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? What is inside is determining, and our text calls it the wellspring, the source. We had missionaries in Africa, and they were getting sick. Everybody in the family was getting sick. Everybody in the family were breaking out in strange rashes, and finally the husband climbed up on the roof, and their water was all contained. It wasn't running water like we have. There was a water cistern. There was a tank up on the roof. And when he pulled back the lid, to his horror, he discovered a huge dead rat. So here they are, they're drinking and they're washing, but the wellspring was bad. You're not gonna have good water with a bad wellspring. Our problem is we don't see our hearts being that big of a deal. There are people, you challenge them about their bitterness, like, okay, I'm a little bitter, but I'm justified. You don't know what they did. That's a small thing to hold on to anger or resentment. Oh, okay, I'm a little rebellious. Why are you making a fuss about rebellion anyway? All right, I got a little problem with lust or greed or pride, but doesn't everyone? Genesis 19:10, Lot is commanded by the angel, get out of here, because judgment is coming. They told him to go far away, and he said, but can't I go to this town that's close. It's called Zoar, and the word means little or small. There's something in him. He's like, what is the big deal? Near, far, wherever you are. You know the song, right? What's... But in that little place, Zoar, that he didn't think was such a big deal, he winds up getting drunk and involved in perversion with his own daughters. Our text calls it the heart, the wellspring. You can't have a wrong heart and make right choices. You can't have a bad heart and make good choices. Bad hearts make bad choices. You have to understand that. I began this sermon with an illustration of a compass. I tell you, the heart is like a compass. When you want certain things, when you see things in a certain way, it will take you places. Please listen to me. We can't survive bad hearts. You know, in America, the number one cause of death, men or women, heart disease. One out of every four people that die in America, it's their heart. I've been saved almost 44 years. It's wonderful to have a long time of salvation. But let me tell you the downside of being saved a long time. The downside is when I look back, the people who witnessed to me are no longer saved. The people who baptized me, I have the picture of my baptism, they're not around. People that I was in bands or ministry with, several of them are no longer around. I look at wedding photos, Lisa's sister and us and everybody else, they're all gone. People we were launched out with on the same night, people we labored with, people who encouraged me, inspired me, that I said I wanted to be like them. They're no longer around. And in every single case, the leading cause of death is the heart. Oh, in one person, it was pride. In another one, it was greed. In another one, it was lust. In another one, it was rebellion. But at the end of the day, they ignored the wisdom of our text. Guard your heart. It will take you places. Guard your heart. Everything flows from the heart. Let's talk secondly about guarding your heart. Two dimensions we see in our text. Number one, it speaks about an external or outside guarding of the heart. We need to guard our hearts against anything from outside that would get inside and affect our hearts. That's what we look at. Verse 25, let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. The eyes give entrance to the soul. In the Bible, it uses the eyes as a picture. It calls them gates, points of entrance. What you read, what you watch, you let it inside. Some people don't understand this. Our text warns about this. Lust, you know, yeah, I'm looking. Woo, check her out. Check him out. But our text says this is going to affect your heart where you go. Verse 26, make level paths for your feet. Take only ways that are firm. The problem is believers who want to go to unhealthy places. And for you, fill in the blank. Where is it that you go? It's not good for you. Maybe it's because there are unhealthy people there. 1 Corinthians 15:33. Don't be misled. Bad company corrupts good character. Lisa and I were first saved, when we first went in the ministry. Some of our first converts, they were biker chicks from a motorcycle gang called Satan's Riders. Had a girl get saved powerfully, just broken home, broken life, got saved. God was doing miracles in her life. But of course, a lot of her friends, they were still going to the bars because they weren't saved. She liked her friends, and so she was still going to the bars. She had stopped drinking, but she's just going to be with her friends, you know, because I've known them all my life. She told me when we went back for the 25th anniversary, I think it was, of the pioneering of that church, and she told a story. She said, "I'm truly saved. I'm going to bars," and the bars that she went to, they're probably their biker bars. And she says, "I'm in there, and a guy spills his drink all down me. And I look down at my beer-stained clothes, and it hit me, what am I doing here? I'm a Christian. Why am I here with these people?" And she said, "I never went back again." Tells us what you're aimed at will affect you. Verse 27, don't swerve to the right or the left. Keep your foot from evil. It's talking about where you aim your life. There are people that aim their lives at selfishness, at carnality. There are people, they're Christians. They don't want to burn in hell, but they want to be just like the world, like sinners, and the way they think and the way they talk, their dress and their actions. Here, let's play a little visual game. Here is evil. Sorry about all the people on this side. Here is evil. Over here is goodness. This is safety. Now, who is in the greatest danger? The person who knows the evil is over there but stays here? Or the person who lives right to the edge of evil? I don't really want to be a sinner. I don't really want to go to hell, but I want to be like right. I fear that's how some of you live. Like you're here tonight because you don't want to burn in hell, but this is how you are. You're like, what? And then when a person steps over the line, no way. Of course they did. Because they didn't guard their heart. Then our text says the greater issue is the internal guarding of the heart. Listen, I love you all. I would love to say that under my wonderful ministry, everyone is fantastic, but then let's wake up and get real. We all have things inside of us already that are unhealthy and can do damage. Jesus put it this way, Mark 7, 21 through 23, "For from within, out of the heart of man proceed evil thoughts, adultery, fornication, murder, theft, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness." He says all these evil things come from within. I don't know if you know this. We all have a capacity. Let's take the nicest one. To be foolish. We all have the capacity to sin, to make bad decisions, whether that is inborn sinful tendencies, whether you have family curses at work in your life, whether that is learned behavior, you watched your parents do things that weren't right, whether it's past violations that have produced bitterness and anger inside of you, whether it's past events that things didn't work out, and so therefore you have become filled with unbelief and you won't trust God. Maybe some of you, you had someone in authority treat you badly in the past, so now you live, you think it's okay. I had someone in authority do me wrong, so that's why I'm not going to trust you. The heart, it's in there. And part of the reason why the heart is so dangerous is because it is hidden and unseen. We can be blinded to dangerous things in our heart. We can think we're doing great. Psalm 139, 23 and 24, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties. And see if there is any wicked way in me. And lead me in the way everlasting. This is a prayer. It's an honest prayer. He's saying, God, I love you. I want to do right. But God, if I'm whacked out and I can't see it, you better show me. Honesty in prayer. Sometimes you pray and the Lord apparently didn't say anything, but let's talk about people. You get warning signs from other people. You know the old saying, if one person calls you a donkey, ignore them. If 50 people call you a donkey, buy a saddle. Yeehaw! So I'm doing great. Why are you in conflict with everyone? Pay attention to the tension. That's a warning sign. You're not doing as good as you think you are. I'm doing great. Well, how come people who know you best or people in authority, they say, you're not doing well at all. Through the years, you discover this. As I say, I've been saved almost 44 years. I rattled through people. I gave you a list, and some of those lists, I'm telling you, were painful. It was a catastrophe. I had close friends. I have family members. They've done insane things, and then it's shocking. But you know what is good about that is I've had some friends and family make dumb decisions, and that's very good because it made me assess myself and say, I'm kind of like that. I kind of think like that. Oh, God. Maybe there's things in there that I didn't see. And that is very healthy. Part of guarding our hearts involves a ruthless removal of unhealthy things that are inside of us. If there are things inside that are not good, confess it to God, of course. That's why we have the altar call at the end. So you can come to God. You can talk to Him. Ask for help. Nehemiah, as they're building the wall, they had a command. You know what? We're going to have to clean out the rubbish. If we're going to build, if we want something good, what comes first? Take out the garbage. Clean the rubbish. The rubble. The Old Testament. They were going to take over the promised land. There were houses already built. They said there are going to be some houses that are defiled. Strange text. You can read it. It talks about leprosy in the house. And he gives it. If it's got, you can do this. If it's defiled, you can take steps to clean it. But God says there are some houses, burn it. That's pretty ruthless, isn't it? Like, what? Why would it? Because it'll kill you, that's why. Got some pictures I want to show you. This is a company in New York. They clean houses of hoarders, and these are apartments that are actually in a millionaire section. These people are actually wealthy. Let's look at a few pictures. We'll look at them fast so you don't gross out. This is rat feces here inside the house. Next picture. living room. This is in a house millionaires live around here. Next picture. Filled with rubbish. Next picture. The refrigerator. How'd you like some food out of that? Next picture. This dog has been dead for 8 months inside the house. Is there another picture? That's the last one. Take it off before they want to run to the toilet here. You know why I show you that? Because this is the possibility in our hearts. We can have that in there. I love the Lord. What is that smell? You better pay attention. We have to. That has to go. But it has to go. Because God says it's life and death. Look at one final thought. Let's talk about life in the heart. Our text gives the promise of life. Life is better than death. Wouldn't you agree? Death is not inevitable. And our text says life comes through the word of God. Verse 20, my son, pay attention to what I say. Listen closely to my words. Do not let them out of your sight. Keep them in your heart, for they are life to those who find them and health to a man's whole body. God's word brings life. God's word brings health. That involves reading God's word. Simple question. You don't have to lift your hand. Did you read your Bible today? Because, I'm busy. Because our text says, you want to guard your heart? What does he say next? My words. This is now talking about the word of God. They are life. It's an issue of value. Pay attention. Listen closely. Don't let it out of your sight. Listen, if you don't love God's word, if reading the Bible is such a chore, I guess. Oh, listen. It's life. Ask God. You can't survive like that. God, if you've grown cold and have no appetite for the things of God, you need to cry out and say, God, give me a love for your word. Putting God's word in our heart, partly by reading, partly by memorizing. I was a young teenager. I started reading my Bible. And I wanted to stay saved. Started memorizing scriptures. There'd be things that I knew maybe that I would wrestle with, and so I'd memorize a scripture. I want to get it inside of me, valuing preaching and teaching of God's word. I know that we've had COVID and sickness, and we've had a million things. That's fine. There are people, they just blow off church like, I just don't feel like going to church tonight. This is not a social club. God's word is going out. People here, pastors, they labor in the word of God in Sunday school. Like, I'll just wander in just before church. You don't love life, because our text says God's word brings life. And then, of course, obeying God's word. I don't care how much you read and memorize. If you don't do it, it's never going to help you. Second thing. Life comes through God doing a miracle in damaged hearts. I know in preaching this, there are people that you are sitting there going, too late. It's too late. I've already let things in. I've already done damage. I already fell in sin. I already made bad decisions. I tell you, God does not give up on people with damaged hearts. Just if you had heart disease, like in the early 1900s, you were dead. There was nothing that they could do for you. But now, that's not the case. Jesus appeared to Peter after his failure. The temple in the Old Testament, it was built on the spot of David's failure in numbering the people. He bought the land of Arunah. The temple was built on a place of failure. Psalm 51:10, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Two things. He says, God, I need you to renew, make new again. There are things in me that used to be good, but now they're damaged. And he's saying, God, I need you to renew it. I need that to be healed. I need it to be brought back to like it was when it was good. But then this is an honest prayer. Create in me a clean heart. He says there are things, it's just not in there. Doing right, loving God's will, it's just not in there. He says, God, create it. Put it in there if it's missing. I'm telling you, God is willing, but that depends on a Bible word called repentance. To repent means you see it like God sees it. God, the way that I've been living, what I've been letting in, it is wrong, and I don't want to be that way. Repentance is not, I'm so sorry I got caught, or I'm so sorry you're upset with me. I'm so sorry there are consequences. That's not repentance. Repentance is, God, my heart is not right, and I know that. And I'm asking for a miracle. I don't want to be this way. I close with this story. 1991, 9-year-old Justin Steiner, he loved climbing. He loved Spider-Man. So he would climb everything and pretend he was Spider-Man. He climbed up on a roof in his hometown of Sierra Vista, Arizona, when he fell off. The house was under construction, and he fell onto a 4-foot piece of rebar sticking straight out of the ground. The metal rod went in just under the breastbone, completely penetrated, went through his heart, and came out his neck. Justin hung on the rod 2 feet off the ground for 20 minutes. Paramedics got there. They cut off 2.5 feet of the rod, and they left in an 18-inch long piece of rebar that went right through his heart. They flew him by helicopter to Tucson. They didn't start surgery for 3.5 hours after the accident. But surgeons were stunned to find, even though the rod pierced the heart in two places and divided the jugular vein, it didn't bleed. They said, it's amazing. Dr. Philip Richmond, one of the three surgeons, said, this is one in a billion. They spent 2.5 hours extracting this section of steel rod from Justin Steiner's chest and neck. And when he awoke from surgery, Justin asked to play Nintendo. He went home 4 days later. Look at this picture. This is Justin at school just a few weeks later. You know how it is? You get shot in the heart. You get stabbed, you're dead. But sometimes, God can do a miracle. And there are people here tonight, that's what you need. By all rights, what you've let in, what you've done already, you should be dead. It should be all over. And yet, I'm telling you, God is the great physician who's able to reach in the rubble and the rubbish, the garbage of our hearts that we have damaged by our choice, and he doesn't give up, and he is able to do a miracle in us. And that's why our text says, guard your heart. Let's bow our heads. close our eyes all across this place. Thank God, with our heads bowed and our eyes closed. Now, my challenge, there are people that are here, you literally, your heart is not right with God. You've never even started the process of having your heart right with God. You're living in sin. I read a list of all the unclean things that we can have in our heart. It talked about sexual issues. It talked about pride and bitterness and all kinds of things. There are some of you, while I'm preaching, you're saying, that's me, that's me, that's me. You know, I showed pictures of the garbage in that apartment. There are people, that's you inside your heart. If people could see on the inside, you would be ashamed. You wouldn't want them to know what's truly in the heart. And that's what sin is. It ruins and destroys everything from the inside out. But I am telling you good news tonight, and that is that Jesus loves you. God loves you so much, He was not willing to leave us with our damaged and broken hearts. He wants to do a miracle from the inside out. The answer is Jesus died on the cross. He paid with His blood so we can go free. If you're here tonight and you would be honest, you say, no, my heart is not right with God and I want to get right, I do believe that Jesus died on the cross for me. If you want to pray and have God heal your heart and forgive you of your sin, change you from the inside out, I want you to do something. Everybody's head is bowed. But if that's what you want, I want you to lift up your hand so I can see it. By lifting your hand, you're saying, I want to pray and I want to turn from my sin. How many are here? Lift up your hand all across this place. I need Jesus. I want to get right with God. How many would there be? Lift your hand up. And put it right back down. Pastor Greg, I need Jesus. Lift your hand up right now as God would deal with you. Man, there might be backsliders that are here. This is what happened to you. You didn't guard your heart. You let things in and it's taken you out. Not right with God. What you need to do is get your heart right. How many backsliders? Lift up your hand. I need Jesus. Lift your hand up. I need Jesus. Man, there are young people that are here. You come to church. You think because you're in church, you're okay? Absolutely not. You've got to get your heart right. And God sees all the garbage that's inside. You don't fool Him. You might fool your parents. You don't fool God. Young people need to get right with God tonight. Lift up your hand. I want to turn from my sin. Right now, God, I'm asking for conviction of sin. I rebuke resistance, and I plead the blood of Jesus. God, hearts that are weighing in the balance right now, tip the scale. Let them make good decisions in Jesus' name. How many would there be? You're not right with God. I want to pray. I want to turn from my sin all across this place as God would deal with you. Thank God. In a moment, I'm going to open the altars. There are some of you here, you are allowing, you're not guarding your heart. You know that. Many different issues. What you need to do is come and be honest with God and say, God, I need a miracle. Some of you are in despair. The devil tells you it's too late. It is not. Come and get your heart right and ask God to do a miracle inside of you. Let's all stand up to our feet. Amen. They're going to sing. The altars are open. I'm inviting you to come and pray. Amen. Go ahead and sing. presence. Restore unto me
the joy of thy salvation, and renew right spirit within me. Create,
oh God, help us, I pray, Lord God. Oh God, do miracles in our hearts, Lord God. I'm asking for transformation. Hallelujah, Lord God. Let's praise God together right now. Father God, I thank you. God, I believe that you are able, Lord God. Thank you for forgiveness, Lord God. Thank you for the truth of your word. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Praise God, praise God, amen. No doubt there are people that are here that you have issues that need to be sorted out after you leave. There are things that God put his finger on your heart. He put his finger on some of the garbage that you have hidden, but he knows what it is. And I'm challenging you when you leave that you deal with that, so that God is able to fully heal your heart. Let's praise the Lord together again. God, I thank you. Oh, God, thank you for your faithfulness, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus.